us have this press conference here today. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Power to the people.
Power to the people.
My name is Lawrence Hamm. I'm the chairman of the People's Organization for Progress, a grassroots organization, an all-volunteer organization that works for racial, social, economic justice, and peace. And we have called this press conference today to announce an event that will be coming up this summer, a very important event. And that event is titled the Million People's March Against Police Brutality, Racial Injustice, and Economic Inequality. And this march is scheduled to take place on Saturday, July 25th, here in Newark, New Jersey. It will begin at 12 o'clock noon, and the starting point for the march is the Lincoln Monument here in Newark, New Jersey, at the intersection of West Market Street and Springfield Avenue. And this march was called by the People's Organization for Progress, but it has been endorsed by a number of community, grassroots, labor, religious, and student organizations. We have about 40 endorsing organizations, and that number is growing, and we expect it to increase before the march to 100 organizations. We are calling this march in response to the ongoing epidemic of police brutality in the United States of America. We see the murder of unarmed black men, women, and children, not exclusively black. The victims of police brutality do come from all races, but we know statistically, overwhelmingly, the majority are African Americans. We call this march in protest to the ongoing murder of unarmed black men, women, and children, the violation of people's constitutional rights by the police, discriminatory and disparate treatment of African Americans and other people of color by the police, and even the police terror in the black community. We saw recently a settlement in Chicago, not simply of one case of someone being the victim of excessive force, but where black men were systematically tortured in Chicago, Illinois, by police. And we believe this to be not just a Chicago problem, but this is a national problem. And even here in Newark, New Jersey, after years of protests by the People's Organization for Progress and other groups, the Justice Department came in at the behest of the New Jersey chapter of the American Civil Liberties Union and did a study of the Newark Police Department over several years, and found that Newark police systematically violated the constitutional rights of citizens here in Newark, that they did engage in the use of excessive force, and that some units of the police even engaged in criminal behavior. And as a result of that, there will be a consent decree here in Newark, and there will be a federal monitor put over the Newark Police Department. But something great happened this summer. We saw the election of a new mayor in Newark, New Jersey, Ras Baraka. And Mayor Baraka embraced the efforts of the Justice Department. And I'm proud to stand here and say that after 50 years of demands by the citizens of Newark for Police Review Board, Mayor Baraka signed an executive order last week to create and establish a Police Review Board here in Newark. first time in 350 years. So we've called this march to draw attention to the ongoing problem of police brutality, murder, and terror in the United States, to add to the energy that is being exhibited nationwide, that is building into a movement for police reform. And as we demand justice for the many victims of police brutality all over the country, we also demand justice for the victims of police brutality right here, for Abdul Kamal, for Jerome Reed, and for Kashad Ashby. And their mothers are here today, and you're going to hear from them. So we're pressing to build a mass movement. This march is to help build a mass movement. This march is also to press for structural and policy reforms within the police departments, not only in New Jersey, but across the country. So those are the main reasons that we have called this march. And we have a number of elected officials, community leaders, activists have joined us today to put forward this call for the Million People's March Against Police Brutality, Racial Injustice, and Economic Inequality. And right now, I'd like to bring forward the mayor of Newark, who I remember as an activist himself. I can remember when he led marches out of the Central Ward of Newark related to the murder of Strawberry Daniels, right there on Clinton and Chadwick. And at that time, the marches were so strong, it almost created a police review board then, but fate had it that he would, in fact, deliver that reform to us. So I'm proud to present now the mayor of Newark, New Jersey, Ras J.
I'm here to show my support for this march. It is long overdue and it's important here in the city. As soon as I got up, all the cameras perked up. Also with Dr. West, who is a longtime advocate and radical in my heart for people, for humanity, in this wonderful edifice. Dr. Howard here, Pastor of the Church. Yeah. It is good to be here this afternoon to support a rally like this. A march that is extremely important. As Larry said, we have a civilian review board that we are organizing now in the city of Newark. There is pushback, but we're pushing back too. They say, get back, we say, fight back. In any event, we're still building a civilian review board. It's going to happen by the grace of God here in the city of Newark. And we will have a model here that other cities will be able to copy. Hopefully, we'll be able to do the things that we've been trying to do for the last 50 years. What is sad is that almost 200 years after Dred Scott in 1857 declared that we had no rights, that the state was bound to respect, that we're still wearing shirts that say Black Lives Matter. Mm-hmm. 200 years later, trying to assert our humanity in this century, which is a problem over all of these years that this stuff is still happening. If you look at what happened in Baltimore, it's appropriate that the march is not just about police brutality, but it's also about economic inequality,
right?
And inequality, period. The first school to leave, to go out to, walk out of their school and have the first conflict in the mall was a school called Frederick Douglass High School.
Mm.
In 1925, I believe, Dr. Howard, the graduating class of Frederick Douglass High School graduated Thurgood Marshall. Thurgood Marshall was a graduate of Frederick Douglass High School, and some 60 years later, the person who fought for Brown versus Board of Education, the school that he graduated from is still 90% segregated and over 75% economically deprived. Mm-hmm. So there's a difference between when he went to school and what's happening now. It's gotten worse economically. Mm-hmm. because our conditions in this community is getting worse. We still have 5 decades of unemployment. That's twice that of the United States and the national average. In some cities, African-American males are over 50% unemployed. There's a serious gap between income, between African-Americans, Latinos, and the rest of the country. There's a growing and widening gap, as a matter of fact, that we have to do something about. And I think that this march tries to highlight those things, and that's why we support it. We're doing everything that we can in government to be able to fight that on that front, to be able to create jobs, to living wage jobs, to fight for living wage jobs, to fight for earned sick days, to make sure people get above the minimum wage. These are things that we have to struggle for. And again, put things in place to fight police brutality. It's not about individual police officers and their acts, because they're individual police officers who do great things, like consistently, that you can read about. I was able to go to a police awards thing and listen to police officers who've done incredible things on the force, right? So it's not about individual officers, it's about a system that protects the bad acts of officers and neglects to provide justice in an environment where black, brown, and poor people are concerned, right? So it doesn't matter if a black police officer or white police officer or any kind of police officer enacted the act that people say it can't be racist because black police officers are doing it too. All that means is that it has become endemic and systemic, and it doesn't matter who's there, that the kind of justice that's given out across America is still run by Jim Crow. Right. So it's important for us to we're going to do our part here in the city of Newark. It's difficult, but we're going to do our part. We know we need partners like Larry Hamm and People's Organization for Progress. We stand with the People's Organization for Progress and all the other organizations that are standing here today to say no more police brutality, to say we need equal justice in America, and to say, more importantly, we need economic justice for all Americans, no matter who you are.
That's right. Thank you. Let's give the man another round of applause. From his busy day, and I asked permission from Pastor Howard to do what I'm about to do, because it's really not the proper protocol, but sometimes I've noticed that some of the rallies we have, the very people we're fighting for end up speaking last.
That's right, sir.
So I'm going to reverse that today.
That's right.
I'm going to reverse that today. We're marching on July 25th for all the victims of police brutality.
That's right.
We're marching for Michael Brown, died in Ferguson, for Eric Garner, in Staten Island, for Ayanna Jones, in Detroit, Michigan, for Rakia Boyd. We're marching for the couple that was killed in Cleveland with 137 shots. But we don't have to go to Ferguson or Staten Island or Detroit. We have our own Michael Brown and Eric Garner's and Rakia Boyd's right here in New Jersey. One of those cases is that of Abdul Kamal. Abdul Kamal was killed in November of 2013. He was shot 15 rounds, was fired at him, 10 bullets hit him and killed him dead. Professor West, he had a cell phone in his hand.
Lord, have mercy.
The mother of Abdul Kamal is here to endorse the march and talk about her son's case. Let's welcome Michelle Kamal. Give her a big hand.
Thank you, everyone. I'm going to say something, and I would appreciate it if I did not delete this, but I have to give honor to God, because without God,
amen.
I cannot do what I do.
Amen.
God strengthens me every day,
yeah.
Gives me the will to do what I do.
That's right.
Dr. Howard, Dr. West, the mayor, chairman, all of my pop family, and everyone else that's here. My son was murdered November the 11th, 2013, by Irvington Police. And like the mayor said, this is not a race thing. It was black cops that shot my son. There were 3 black officers, so it's not a race thing. It's a systemic problem.
Mm.
It's a problem in the environment that these police officers work in. You know, they may come from our community, they may want to do the right thing, but I believe once they get into that environment, things change. So it's not a race problem, but it's not just about police brutality, it's about the way we live, it's about our community. So we want to come, everyone to come out, we want them to come out in strong, in groups, that come out to support us, because this is important. It's been a long time coming, we need it to happen, we need people to mobilize, we need people to understand what we're doing and why we're doing it. So I just want to, my pastor always say, I'm not going to be before you long, I just want to say what I have to say. I'm straight to the point, and I don't believe in throwing anything out. So I'm just so happy to be here today, I'm just so happy for Pop, I can't express enough to my chairman for what him and the people of Pop have done for me. This is how I came into Pop. We have three mothers at our meetings almost every Thursday in a small room that has lost funds from November 13th until 2014. So we need to come together, we need to stop. I'm not pleased with how I came to Pop, but I am so happy I'm here. Thank you.
There was a video that went viral, and I actually found out about this case through a young man that's going to address you in a little while, Walter Hudson, who is a tremendous activist in South Jersey. He was the one that first made me aware of this case, but many of you probably saw the video that went viral of Jerome Reed getting out of his car in Bridgeton, getting out of a car in Bridgeton, New Jersey, with his hands up, no weapons, and he shot to death at point blank range by Bridgeton police. Jerome's mother and brother are here. I'm going to call them up and ask the mother, and both of them, if they want to say, you want to come up, you want to say a few words? Give her a hand. This is Sheila.
I'm glad to be here today. I'm glad to see so many faces out here to represent me and my family. My son was shot to death on December the 30th, 2014. He was in a car. He got picked up on a rolling stop sign. A police officer walked into the car on the passenger side and asked for identification. My son was sitting on the passenger side. Driver on the driver's side went into the glove compartment, opened up the glove compartment, and there was a weapon in the glove compartment. Officer Dave reached into the glove compartment and took the weapon out and told them to put their hands up. My son was so confused about putting his hands up or down because Worley told him to put his hands up and get out the car. All that on the video, if everybody looked at the video, you'll see what I was talking about. I'm distorted because I lost a son. I have three sons and a stepson. And I have one stepson and two sons. I'm going to miss my baby. And my son looks like a place was going on.
How you doing?
How are you?
My name is Sean Reed. As far as the day, they don't know what's going on with the case. Prosecutors in prison. Not telling us nothing. Today is the same thing. My birthday is coming up. I'm missing my brother. He didn't deserve what happened to him. And all I can say is I hope the officers get what they deserve. And all we want is justice. I'm tired of this. I didn't get mates and everything here. No, he didn't deserve to get shot. He had his hands up. But that's all I got to say. Like real emotional right now. Like,
Thank you for listening. Everybody,
thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Sheila and Sean. Regarding the cases of Abdul Kamal, Jerome Reed, and Kashad Ashford, Rashad's family is not here. They may be here before the conclusion of this press conference. With regard to the case of Abdul Kamal. We're marching on July 25th. For, among other things, we want the U.S. Attorney, Paul Fisher, to launch a civil rights investigation into the death of Abdul Kamal. We believe that Abdul's civil rights were violated, and we want the U.S. Justice Department under Paul Fisher to immediately launch a civil rights investigation and, if warranted, bring civil rights charges against those officers responsible for the death of Abdul Kamal. With regard to the case of Jerome Reed, we unite with the activists from Bridgeton, New Jersey, and the family, with Walter Hudson, in the call for the case to be taken out of the hands of the Cumberland County prosecutor and to be put into the hands of a special prosecutor or the state attorney general. And with regard to the death and the case of Kashad Ashford, who was shot 9 times in the head by state troopers and Lyndhurst police, this case is already in the hands of the state attorney general because state troopers were involved in the shooting. But efforts are being made to keep all documents and information regarding the case confidential. We want all documents and information and evidence made public in the case. We want the family can't even get any information on what's going on with the case. We think that that is wrong and that information should be made public and especially accessible to the family. We have many other demands, and as we go along through the press conference, I'll bring some of those up. But right now, I want to bring forward the pastor of this great church, who is an old friend of mine. People don't know how long we've known each other, but our friendship is at least 30 years old. It precedes him becoming the pastor of this church. I knew the previous pastor, Pastor Scott, here because our first Martin Luther King program was held here at Bethany Baptist Church almost 33, 32 years ago when we first started celebrating Dr. King. But Reverend Howard is the former president of the National Council of Churches. He is an international leader. He's met all the great leaders of the world. He was a major force in the anti-apartheid movement. And many of you remember the campaign of Jesse Jackson. That campaign took off after it was arranged for Reverend Jackson to go and get Flight Lieutenant Goodman from Syria. The man who actually arranged that was Reverend Howard. So I'm proud to bring forward my dear friend and a freedom fighter, Reverend M. William Howard.
Could have gone on, and he made me nervous. Although I'm about to retire from Bethany, you could have gotten me fired if you kept going. But it's a great pleasure to stand here and say to you that we're meeting in this room today because the diaconate of Bethany Baptist Church has endorsed the march. To allow the press conference to take place here and for the organizers of the march to meet here on a regular basis. So we are happily identified with this effort. And I want to say welcome to the POP people and to all of our brothers and sisters, and we welcome back to Bethany Dr. Cornel West, who I'm about to give an envelope. He comes here so often, we're going to give him a donation. But to all of our sisters and brothers, and let me recognize Reverend Felix Tinkson, if I may. Reverend Tinkson, just stand up there so we can see you. Memorial Baptist Church here in Newark, which is the first Baptist church, founded in 1801. And it was the church where the organizers of Bethany were allowed to meet before they were organized.
Wow.
So that they might worship and so on. And in 1871, of course, this church was organized. Why have the deacons and deaconesses of our church embraced this effort? Police brutality. And the real kernel source of all of this, economic inequity and violence in our community, these are real. And the Church of Christ must stand with all who dare to witness against these realities, these evils that have torn the social fabric of American society, not just Essex County and Newark. We aim to be a good citizen in the place where we were founded 144 years ago. And our effort is to be true to what we believe is the eternal gospel of Jesus Christ. This is why we are involved. This is why we are gladly associating our efforts with this march and with POP. Go to the website of Bethany Baptist Church. We have a number of affiliates, organizations with whom we work, and the People's Organization for Progress, and their logo, and this loud yellow that you see is right on our website. And I think the mayor, who is so eloquent and so clear-headed on these issues, talked about asserting our humanity. He made reference to this, asserting our humanity in reference to Dred Scott. Let me say, I'm from Gut Bucket, Georgia. I grew up in Jim Crow, down in the valley. What I have to say is that if we don't stand up for our humanity, ain't nobody gonna do it. We're standing up for our humanity. And let me just say, in connection with this, that even before the march occurs, I'm going to shamelessly tell you that on Saturday, men, we have a men's health screening in this church from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. And I'm going to invite the women to take the men in your life by the arm and bring them to get screened for good health, because without our health, we can't fight. And the next thing I want to say is that after church on Sunday morning, we're having a focus for our young people on the STEM careers. Sunday morning, we're encouraging young people to pursue careers in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics.
Wow.
Because the truth is, we came to Newark, Larry, looking for low-skill, semi-skill, unskilled jobs. We came from the rural South, we came from the Caribbean, wherever we came from. We came looking for those factory jobs that have disappeared. So when we fight the economic, against economic inequity, we're going to also have to fight for increased skills and the capacity to compete for the emerging new job opportunities. Because my fear is that we will have a dramatic job growth in the city of Newark without the most needy persons in Newark being able to viably compete with us now. So economic inequity is at the root of all of this, and I hope that we will keep our eye on this prize. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor. And once again, I want to issue a call to every human being in the United States of America that is opposed to police brutality, the violation of people's constitutional rights, police terror, and murder, to join with us, to march with us in Newark, New Jersey on Saturday, July 25th, 12 o'clock noon, as we meet at the Lincoln Memorial here in Newark. You don't have to go to Washington for a Lincoln Memorial. We got one right here in Newark. And we're going to fill the streets of downtown Newark and let the world know that all of us stand in opposition to police brutality, that we want to change. People want to get the complete mission statement for our march. They can go to the Million People's March Against Police Brutality Facebook page. There you will find the mission statement for the march. You can also go to the People's Organization for Progress website, www.njpop.org, or people can call directly the People's Organization for Progress at 973-801-0001. Now I'd like to bring another friend who's no stranger to us. He is certainly an international personality. He is one that I think all academics should aspire to be like, to take knowledge out of the ivory tower and put it in the service of the people. He is an author, an intellectual, a public intellectual. He's written over 19 books. But that's not why we know him. We know him because wherever the people are fighting for justice, if he's called, he's there. And he's been with us before. So I'd like to bring forward now Dr. Cornel West.
I am blessed to be here. And I'm here because the tears of the mothers and the brothers and the sisters are not in vain. We're here because we love our people.
Mm-hmm.
And when you love folk, you hate the fact that they're being treated unjustly.
That's right.
You loathe the fact they're being treated unfairly. When I stand here in this church consecrated 144 years ago, I'm humbled by those who had the vision to say, we're going to keep this love train running in the face of a vicious legacy of white supremacy.
Yes.
And it's no easy thing to stand on this consecrated ground because you have to be ready. You have to be prepared. And I stand alongside my dear brother Larry Hamm, who was such a visionary and courageous leader now for over 40 years when I met him, mm-hmm. and he's still on fire. It's a beautiful thing to be on fire. Give it up. And it is true, brother Bill Howard, when I met him 40 years ago, same smile on his face, but he knows the hell that poor people and working people have been catching of all colors, but he also knows that he begins on the chocolate side of town. Because we live in an age where there's too many black leaders in love with everybody but black people.
Well,
let alone loving everybody, but if you can't love your mom and your daddy and your grandparents, something is wrong with you. So this march is a love march.
Yes.
Got some geniuses from Teaneck, New Jersey, said the black freedom struggle was a caravan of love. This is a love march. And Brother Martin reminded us, justice is what love looks like in public.
Right.
Just like Curtis Mayfield reminds us, tenderness is what love feels like in private. That's the tradition that this church comes out of. That's the tradition that I'm a small part of. And I want to salute my dear brother Mayor. He comes from a family of radical democratic nobility and black royalty.
Indeed.
Mary Baraka. We need to help him out. We want him to be the Harold Washington of his
grandson of a deacon.
And grandson of a deacon of Bethany Baptist, right? Oh, the roads lead back to Bethany. No, but we want him to be the Harold Washington of his generation, and he's in the process of becoming it, but he can't do it on his own. When you get on the inside, you need outside help.
That's right.
And we want to make sure that policemen are accountable, not in the form of some abstract investigation of a department. We want the policemen to go to jail when they kill somebody. Responsibility is all it's about, but it's not in the spirit of revenge. We don't come from a people of hatred and revenge. Come from a people of love and justice. If we were a people of hatred and revenge, you wouldn't have an American democracy. It'd be a civil war every generation. That's what Martin King was about. That's what Fannie Lou Hamer was about. That's what Ella Baker was about. That's what Frederick Douglass, Sojourner Truth, Harriet Tubman were about. America ought to thank black people. We have a caravan of love rather than a caravan of revenge, but we do want justice.
Yes, sir.
And this March, July the 25th, is going to be hot.
Yeah.
In a number of different ways. Climate's going to be hot. People going to be upset.
Yes.
Going to be mad because they're tired.
Yes.
Arbitrary police power. But it's going to be challenged through love and justice, because you got high quality leadership and you got black people of integrity, honesty, and decency in the face of too much arbitrary police power. That's what's going on in Newark. That's why Newark can easily become the vanguard, because you know it's a Ferguson moment. You know it's a Baltimore moment. Newark is still wrestling with the same thing, but it comes to the surface in terms of its quality of leadership. That's what Larry Anderson Friend Organization has been about. That's what this church has been about. That's what the best of black people in Newark has been about. You don't produce the greatest vocal artists in the history of the 20th century named Sarah Vaughan out of Newark. So I'm glad to be here. And as you say, I'm not an outsider.
No, sir.
I live on 122nd Street in New York City.
Uh-huh.
But I'm not an ally. I'm a freedom fighter.
That's right.
And I come in solidarity with what's going on in Newark, just like I do the same thing in Ferguson and Oakland and Dallas and Detroit and Dayton, just in Cincinnati just 2 days ago. And on my way back to Baltimore. We're going to have a year massive civil disobedience, as you know, in Ferguson, in August.
Really?
Oh, Lord, yes, massive. We're going to have a massive march October 10th in New York City. I'm fixing myself that we stopped mass incarceration. You know, Mr. Louis Farrakhan is having the 20th anniversary of the Million Man March, October 22nd. So there's going to be a number of mass marches.
Yes.
But this Newark march is going to be the first one. And in many ways, it could easily be the best one. You know, wonderful. So I'm just blessed to be here. Thank you for allowing me to be here. Thank you. Let's give Brother Cornel West a big hand.
There are a number of people I want to bring before you, and I'm going to try to bring as many of them as I can in the time that we allow. But let me just say, again, we want everybody to come to Newark, New Jersey, July 25th. We're calling this the Mean People's March Against Police Brutality, Racial Injustice, and Economic Inequality. With regards to police brutality, we are calling for a number of reforms. Right now, there are no fewer than 6 bills in the New Jersey State Legislature that deal with some aspect of police brutality. We call for the passage of those bills, particularly the bill that would create a special prosecutor to deal with issues that involve the police, issues of police brutality that involve the police. There's a residency requirement bill for new police. We also support that bill. So we support the bills in the state legislature. We also support some legislation at the federal level Congressman John Conyers has introduced the End Racial Profiling Act. The People's Organization for Progress calls on Congress to support, not only to support, but to pass that piece of legislation. With regard to racial injustice, as we remember, and we have slave labor going on in our prisons. One of the reasons we have so much recidivism is because these prisoners are being used as slave labor. Do y'all know that prisoners make $1.30 a day, 22 cents an hour? They can't even pay the fees that are imposed upon them when they leave prison. So we're calling for the prison wages to be increased from 22 cents an hour to the state minimum wage of $8.38 an hour. That's what prisoners should be getting in our prison. They shouldn't be getting slave wages. These are just some of the demands that we have. And I agree, I heard the mayor say the other day, and I'll repeat this, and it's been an oft-repeated demand. I'm old enough now to remember generations of demands, but just as there was a Marshall Plan to rebuild the cities of Europe after World War II, we need a Marshall Plan to rebuild the city of the United States of America. We need a Marshall Plan. We remember that during the Great Depression, there was unemployment close to 25% in the United States. What did the Roosevelt administration do? They created the WPA and the CCC and other jobs programs. In fact, the Newark City Subway, which runs today, the same light rail you ride, that was a WPA project built in 1938. And they built it so well, it's still running today. The Roosevelt administration put 11 million people back to work with these job programs. We need a national jobs program now that gets the people 22 million unemployed and underemployed back to work. So these are some of the demands, just some of the demands that we will be raising on July 25th. We have a young lady who's here with us, has been Brother West in the firestorm, in the hurricane of controversy, because her students engaged in an act of compassion and sent a letter to a prison inmate who was near death, and many of you know the name of that inmate. His name was Mumia Abu-Jamal. Yeah. Mumia Abu-Jamal. And Mumia is very ill, and when Black History Month came around, this teacher was examining both conventional and unconventional Black leaders. And anybody that knows anything about the contemporary Black freedom struggle knows that Mumia Abu-Jamal is considered a national leader. He's done more behind bars, far more cause than many of us who have our freedom have done. But he became very ill. And the students hear about this. They wrote letters to Mumia. And for this, this teacher was terminated by the Orange Board of Education. That's disgraceful. We say justice for Marilyn Zuniga. Reinstate Marilyn. Put her back. We need more teachers like Marilyn Zuniga. I want Marilyn Zuniga to come forward. She wants to say she deserves the support of the community teachers. Give her a big hand. Give her a big hand.
Our students' reality. And that's why I do the work that I do, and that's why I'm in public school classrooms teaching our students the truth. And that's
we have the mayor of Newark here endorsing the march. We have two city council presidents here. And I want to introduce, since we're in Newark, Donna, let me deal with the Newark City Council president first. The president of the Newark City Council, Milton Crump. Give him a big hand. Come on, Milton. Come on, and a member of Bethany Baptist Church.
And my brother is strong.
Power to the people.
Power to the people.
You know, that's where the power is.
That's right.
It's really in the people. It's not in power. And if you don't believe me, just take a moment to take to read some of our history books. The history of African American people.
Oh, yes.
Power was not given to us. We had to take it.
That's right.
The unfortunate truth is we still have to take it.
Oh, Lord.
And so on July 25th, I have on my flat shoes, my flat hat, and I will be joining. I am so honored to have as my pastor, Moses, let my people go. I do that every now and then when I have a chance to say him, because he is about the business of getting, of having us release the chains that have bound us for so many years. And he is one of those persons who has not been afraid to be in the forefront. You know, sometimes people are reluctant to really put themselves out on the front line. But we have three people and an organization, and I'm a 25-year member of CAC. I just want you all to know. And whenever my schedule permits, I support Larry Hamm to the best of my ability. My brother from another mother. I got in just in time to catch the tail end of your remarks. So I hope that someone is recording this and that someone is going to make some DVDs or whatever they make today, you know, so you can watch. So I can watch what my brother actually.
Recant what my brother has said here this evening. God bless you. See you on the 25th. Yeah. We're going to hear. Rashan, don't leave. Okay. We'll do next. Well, I want to bring forward right now the president of the Orange City Council, Donna K. Williams. We can give her a big hand.
Good afternoon, power to the people.
How
to not be in this room and more in 1967 and know not I'm sitting in a moment in history and see them not coming to heart. And of course, you would bring Milton Crump before me. Because without him, Milton Crump, there would be no Donna K. Williams.
Oh,
because she wrote a letter to a prisoner whose children in my community do every day because the majority of my residents are ex-offenders.
Oh,
and so I pondered on the question that I stood outside of one of the largest with Larry Hamm, and I had the opportunity to be there with Pastor Howard, and everybody was saying, get him off the corners, get him off the corners, get him off the corners. He said, yes. But once we get them off the corners, what's going to do with them then?
Mm-hmm.
So we have to make sure that ex-offender re-entry is just not a term out of our mouth. It's just something that we are really doing, that we're really putting thought behind, and that's what teachers are doing every day. So make sure that when we say things, that we don't say them just to say them, that we're thinking about them, because these are our babies that are out here that we are protecting. I will be with you on July 25th.
Mayor Baraka spoke earlier about the Newark Police Review Board that will be established shortly. The executive order has been signed, and it's now a matter of putting the mechanics into place. One of the organizations that played a major role in shaping the Police Review Board, which will be unlike most of the other police review boards in the United States, it will be stronger than most of the other review boards because of the efforts, one of the New Jersey chapter of the American Civil Liberties Union. Remember, it was ACLU New Jersey, and I believe initiated under former executive director Deborah Jacobs, yes, that triggered the request for the Justice Department to come in. ACLU also played a major role in pulling together a coalition of organizations that worked diligently, a coalition of which People's Organization for Progress was one member of, worked diligently on drafting the executive order to create the Police Review Board. And a staff member of the ACLU and a representative of the NCAP coalition is here today. I want everybody to welcome in the strongest possible way, Ras J. Give him a big round of
applause. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's hard to follow such giants who have spoken before me. But today I'm here representing the ACLU and this coalition that Chairman Hamm talked about, Newark Communities for Accountable Policing, which really is in a lot of ways one of the most unique coalitions that we've seen across the country involving police reform. What North Community Square Council Policing is a coalition of organizations, Garden State Equality, NAACP, HOP, the ACLU, who come together to reform police departments, not only in the state, but across the country. And I think the important thing that it shows is that this is an issue that just doesn't affect black men. That is an issue that affects black women, it's an issue that affects people of the Latino community, it affects trans people, residents in our city, it affects LGBTQ residents in our city. And so this coalition brings together these people to fight for police reform in Newark. And so we're here today to endorse the Million People's March on July 25th. We think it's going to be an incredible march. And there's no better place to have a march like this than here in Newark, a city that is leading the way on police reform across this country. It didn't take a Ferguson moment or a Michael Brown moment or an Eric Garner moment for us to roll up our sleeves and get together and build this civilian complaint review board. So I tip my hat to Mayor Baraka, to Pop, and to all the organizers who were involved in making this possible. And I'm proud to say that we're going to be there on July 25th. And I'm going to make it my personal goal to make sure that we get young people out to this march. I believe that young people of my generation tend to be apathetic to these issues. And if you see the young people sitting in this room, you heard from Maryland, that's not the case. And so we're going to be there in full force. NCAP is proudly endorsing it. I'm happy to be here.
Young people. You see, we need some young people. But the young people of Newark, they on the move. They had a huge demonstration last week. In fact, that's one of the demands of the Million People's March. We want the Newark school system returned to home rule. We want an end to state takeover of public schools. That's one of our demands under racial justice. I wanted to bring her earlier, but we had so many people to get through. I want to bring forward Carol Gay of the New Jersey Industrial Union Council. Give a big hand, Carol Gay.
Good morning, everyone. Bowles, Power to the People.
Power to the People.
I'm a proud member of POP, have been for a few decades, and the New Jersey Industrial Union Council is also proud to endorse, or in fact, we endorsed a few months ago, we endorsed this march a few months ago, and just last weekend, a week, 2 weeks ago, the Labor Fight Back Network, which is a nationwide labor network, also endorsed. And we're endorsing all of the demands of this march against police brutality, racial inequality, and racial injustice for so many reasons already mentioned today. But I just want to second Larry's call for a national jobs program.
Right.
We have a national jobs program, and I just read recently that Freddie Gray's neighborhood in Baltimore, 23% unemployed. So no surprise, you know, when you see neighborhoods exploding, we need jobs. And we need justice, we need especially a fight back against race, against inequality on all levels, living wage jobs. And we are looking forward to being here on July 25th with POP, with all the other organizations, Pastor Hayward, Dr. West, Bethany Baptist, all these wonderful organizations marching for peace, justice, and equality.
All right.
Thank you.
We're going to have two more speakers, and then we'll take some questions, and then we'll call this press conference to an end. The young man I want to bring now has been fighting very hard down in South Jersey. I don't know how many of y'all have been to Bridgeton, but you might as well go to Bridgeton, Alabama. Y'all know they tried to arrest me down there in Bridgeton. They did arrest me down there in Bridgeton. Just snatched me and put me away. But this brother, I have so much admiration for him because you don't have all the support. I mean, sometimes we talk about the lack of support up here, but believe me, it's much easier to organize up here than it is down there in Bridgeton. He's been down there. He has a major case going on now. But I'm proud to bring my brother forward, Walter Hudson, from the National Awareness Alliance, Leadership Alliance.
Power to the people.
Power to the people.
You know, it's great being here today with POP. I will say that POP and National Awareness Alliance, we've been together since 2010 with Moshawn Leach, and they also been with me when Moshawn Leach was killed in Pennsboro. They also was with me in New Brunswick when Barry Deloach was killed, shot to death by two New Brunswick police officers. And they came down in Bristol to support, you know, Jerome Reed family when he was shot to death. So, you know, National Awareness Alliance, as chairman and founder of National Awareness Alliance, I'm standing here today in cohesion with other organizations endorsing the Millions of People March July 25th. In fact, I've been organizing, been on a conference call for the last 2 days, trying to get, you know, buses together coming from Baltimore. Some of my comrades down there with the organizers around Freddie Gray were organizing, you know, busloads coming up, and also in Philadelphia. So, you know, I stand here today to, again, to endorse the Million People March. Throughout the nation, you know, there's been a lot of talk in regards to, you know, police brutality and social, you know, economic inequalities and things like that, but you can't deny what is going on. It's something strange when you have in Colorado James Holmes that can shoot up a movie theater, kill 13 people, injure 50, other people, and then have C4 strapped to his apartment, but yet he's taken into custody, he's going to face the due process. You have Clyde Bundy in Vegas, who was staying on a federal reservation, had weapons, assault weapons, pointed at
government
officials. Not one shot was fired, nor was he arrested. But when it comes to Jerome Reed and Michael Brown and Freddie Gray, we either shot or beat the death. So there's a problem that we have to deal with, not just in Newark, but in the nation. And I believe that this march will bring attention on that, and it has to bring attention on that. And we cannot let the fire die out, because our people are dying. So again, as we say in these marches, if it ain't going to be no justice, it ain't going to be no peace. So in the Jerome Reed case, we're a little bit in the dark as well. What we do know is that they concluded on the investigation of Jerome Reed. And I find it strange, because this is the first time dealing with a police brutality case where they did not, they finished, they concluded with the investigation, but then they give it over to the Attorney General to review it. But under the Attorney General guidelines, when there's a case involving a shooting, it automatically goes to grand jury. So I'm kind of, a little concerned about that. So that's where the case is at right now. So I'm venture to say within 2 weeks we should hear something, but the fight is not over with, because we're joined with POP and other organizations to keep this in the limelight, and we're not going to let it, go down. In fact, Brother Hamm, we're working hard, diligently, to bring some more young people up here. At this point, are there any other groups that wanted to speak, that wanted to make a statement? All right. Are there any questions from any of the members of the press that are left? Well, I want to thank, I want to end the press conference by thanking everybody for coming out. Let us give Bethany and Pastor Howard a big hand. Cornel West, a big hand. Remember now, the work of getting the people to the Million People's March has already begun. We will be meeting tomorrow night at the Abyssinian Baptist Church, 224 West Kinney Street in Newark, 6:30. That's where we do the planning. That's one of the places that we do the planning for the march. We want everybody to come out tomorrow night to help do the work of getting all the people we want to get to Newark on July 25th. And remember, go to Million People's March Against Police Brutality Facebook page. Then go to People's Organization for Progress website, www.njpop.org, or give us a call at 973-801-0001. Thank you, everybody, for coming out.